Out front tonight, Trump is pushing a new conspiracy theory once again about voter fraud. This time, though, it's Google's fault, apparently. Here's his tweet from today. Report just out. Google manipulated from 2.6 million to 16 million votes from Hillary Clinton for Hillary Clinton in 2016 election. This was put out by a Clinton supporter. He continues, not a Trump supporter. Google should be sued. My victory was even bigger than thought. Bigger than thought. There is no evidence of that. There is no real evidence of that, I should say. His theory, based off not a new report even, but congressional testimony from last month. Testimony that got little attention and was largely ignored. That is, until the theory appeared today on Fox Business, discussing claims by a researcher named Robert Epstein, who claims Google may have shifted millions of votes to Hillary Clinton. How? Well, Epstein, the researcher, blames bias in Google search results.
In 2016, Google's search algorithm likely impacted undecided voters in a way that shifted at least 2.6 million votes to Hillary Clinton. The 2.6 million is a rock bottom minimum. The range is between 2.6 and 10.4 million.
But to be clear, there is no evidence that search results were skewed. Additionally, Google denies that. And take it one step further, if search results were biased, there's no evidence that it changed a single vote. But in typical Trump fashion, none of that context matters. Or the fact that all real evidence shows that Hillary Clinton won the popular vote by nearly 3 million votes. Clinton was quick to respond to the president's new claim, tweeting this. The debunked study you're referring to was based on 21 undecided voters, but for context, that's about half the number of people associated with your campaign who have been indicted. Clearly, still, no love lost there. And here is the thing. This isn't the first time that the president has pushed baseless claims about millions of illegal votes in 2016. Remember this from President Trump's policy advisor, Stephen Miller?
Having worked before on a campaign in New Hampshire, I can tell you that this issue of busing voters into New Hampshire is widely known by anyone who's worked in New Hampshire politics. It's very real. It's very serious. This morning on this show is not the venue for me to lay out all the evidence.
There was no evidence. There's no evidence of that. I myself have spoken to the offices of the Secretary of State of New Hampshire and the Attorney General's office way back when he was talking about this, and they didn't then have any evidence of seeing any buses coming in. So there's that, and then there is this.
In many places, like California, the same person votes many times. You probably heard about that. They always like to say, oh, that's a conspiracy theory. Not a conspiracy theory, folks. Millions and millions of people.
There was much illegal voting.
They're voting, like, really early. And we have to discuss that early thing. That's sort of, so many things are going on, so many things. I wonder what happens during the evenings when those places are locked.
Again, no evidence, no matter how many times you say it. But don't take my word for it. The president's own commission to investigate widespread voter fraud found none before it disbanded.
There's new reporting in the Washington Post on White House discussions at a senior level of another tax cut to head off a possible economic slowdown. Now, the Washington Post is citing three people familiar with the talks who say the White House is looking at a possible cut in payroll taxes and that talks are in the early stages. In the meantime, the White House is knocking down this idea, telling us that cutting payroll taxes is not under consideration at this time. They've said the same to the Wall Street Journal. Now, if the Post three sources have it right, what's significant is this move would be evidence that within the White House, there's real concern the economy could be weakening, which is not the message they've been saying publicly at all. In fact, they're running pretty much a media campaign of denial and deflection and scapegoating.
It's just not the way we see it. And of course, it's nice to have the mainstream media finally covering the economy, but they only cover it when they can use Sesame's Grover word of the day, recession.
Grover, by the way, is my favorite longtime resident of Sesame Street. I'm just gonna go on the record on that. He's furry, he's blue, what's not to like? He's not an economist though. On the other hand, this guy is. He's chief economist at Morgan Stanley.
If tariffs go up further to 25% on the balance $300 billion of imports from China and stay there for 4 to 6 months' time, and China does take countermeasures somewhat similar to what we have seen overnight, then we will see global economy entering into recession in three quarters' time, i.e. 9 months' time.
He was focused, as apparently the White House may also be, on a number of policies and economic indicators that could signal trouble ahead. The trade war with China, bond prices, slowing business investment. Now, thankfully, none of those indicators guarantees a recession, and not every economist sees the same degree of danger, but few are dismissing it entirely. Except it seems members of the administration, at least publicly, who've been doing this media blitz the last few days and whose words ring especially false if the Washington Post reporting bears out.
I think we're in pretty good shape, and I want to just say, you know, we should not be afraid of optimism. I don't know what it is. Everybody wants to talk about pessimism, recession.
Is that why
there's
the president...
no recession on the horizon?
Does it sound like everybody's yelling nowadays? Maybe that's just me. That was Larry Kudlow. For the record, he predicted higher economic growth for the last 2 years than the economy actually saw. So he's certainly, let's say, an optimist, just not a very good economic forecaster, which he was asked about on another Sunday show.
Okay, you say that, but, you know, you actually said that in 2007, right before the second worst downturn in American history. This is what you wrote. There's no recession coming. This is in December of 07. The pessimistas were wrong. It's not going to happen. The Bush boom is alive and well. It's finishing up its sixth consecutive year with more to come. The more to come was a massive downturn. So I admire your optimism, but the data is pointing in another direction.
Well, I plead guilty to that late 2007 forecast. I plead guilty.
Well, yeah, there's nothing else you can do. It's on the record. As for Vice President Pence today, he cited a whole new kind of economic indicator, two guys who like beer and the beach.
These two fellas walked by on the beach. True story. A couple of big guys wearing Budweiser T-shirts. One of them looked over at me and he said, hey, you're Vice President Mike Pence. I said, yes, I am. And he said, well, listen, he said, you got to tell the president that he's got to keep doing what he's doing because I made twice as much money last year as I made the year before.
Which is very possible. And if it is true, that's great for them. We all should do twice as well next year. But signs are we won't, or at least that the economy could slow considerably. Now, the administration is looking to put any possible blame for a slowdown elsewhere, which means cue the attacks on the media.
I think what's changed is that the 2.5 years of the collusion hunt and the Mueller report were a big dud. And so now they're searching around and they're trying to burrow into the president's number one issue in the polls.
A memo must have gone out with talking points because the media is also being blamed by spokesperson Hogan Gidley.
Well, they have tried systematically to destroy this president even before he was sworn into office. So you saw it with the marches on Washington, D.C. before he had passed a policy or pushed some type of proposal. It happened from sunup till sundown. The media has been complicit and compliant with those efforts. But listen, first they push Russia, then they push racism, and now they're pushing a recession. The fact is, this economy is doing better than it ever has before.
I'm not disagreeing.
The president set the tone, though, for this particular talking point last week, tweeting, the fake news media is doing everything they can to crash the economy because they think that will be bad for me and my reelection. Today, he also blamed Federal Reserve Chairman Jerome Powell, the person he appointed. Quoting from his tweet, our economy is very strong despite the horrendous lack of vision by Jay Powell and the Fed, but the Democrats are trying to will the economy to be bad for purposes of the 2020 election. Very selfish.